was a vehicle whose loudspeakers blared the color red alarm that is sounded in stereo every time a Qassam rocket is fired. Hundreds of Tel Aviv district policemen, mounted officers, and special forces.
Information indicating that the Russian war fleet intends to return to the Mediterranean Sea in spring. If this should happen, then the port of Kharkiv will be used for ducking Russian military forces.
وفي هذه الحالة يمكن استخدام ميناء طرطوس لتمركز ومرابطة السفن الحربية.
Some newspapers also talked about the possibility of deploying
artillery weapons at discounted prices. However, the two sides have mutual interests now in re-establishing a Russian military presence there.
Celebrate the 29th anniversary of the Islamic Revolution. Many have been brought to the capital by bus. Others walk long distances to attend the ceremony in the square and to listen to the current president, Mahmoud Ahmadinejad.
There are many disturbing factors in the world which deeply concern thinking men. The population explosion, ecological imbalance, dwindling energy supply, threat of famine, new staff and virus strains, the crime epidemic, moral breakdown, plus the ever-present threat of global nuclear war. Any one of these facts pose a threat to man's survival. The question is, which one will strike first? The European Economic Community, the development of electronic funds transfer. You'll be meeting with doctors, professors, scientists, world leaders, and noted biblical scholar, Chuck Smith, who is our special host.
I'm Chuck Smith, and I'm also concerned about man's survival upon this planet. For many years, I've been studying the sociological trends, the population patterns, and the environmental conditions. As man has been living so thoughtlessly as though there were no tomorrow, it is rather frightening to realize that he might awake one of these mornings and find there is no tomorrow. We have carelessly wasted the natural resources that God has given unto us. We have sown to the wind, and now the time has come when we must reap the whirlwind. The population did not reach 1 billion until 1867. Yet by 1935, there were 2 billion people. By 1965, it rose to 3 billion. And by 1975, 4 billion.
We are very close to a time early in the next century when it would be possible, if this process continued, for the total world population to double in 20 years. Well, you wouldn't have to continue this very much longer before the population would be doubling in 20 minutes.
Ozone is a minor but extremely important constituent gas in the stratosphere. Stratospheric ozone screens harmful ultraviolet radiation from the Earth's surface. It is therefore principally the potential effects of increased harmful ultraviolet radiation, such as skin cancer and biological and agriculture effects, that are of concern.
DDT is what you might call the uninvited additive. It is in the food chain, is in man's food chain, it's in the ecosystem of the planet, and it poses a...
From an environmental standpoint, this is an extremely serious situation. The environment has been giving us warnings and serving as a monitor for a long time, and in many ways we haven't heeded those warnings.
Another of the major concerns today is the energy supply on the planet Earth. As man is using up the fossil fuels, which cannot be replaced, he is turning more and more to the use of atomic fuels. These also pose a problem to the survival of man in finding a safe way to dispose of the waste materials that are still highly radioactive. Solar energy has often been suggested as a viable alternative, but with the billions of dollars and also the time needed to develop this resource, it is extremely doubtful if it can be ready in time to avoid disaster. When the age of industrialization came, it seemed to promise man a utopia, a way to improve the quality of life on the Earth. The need for fuel necessary to run this industrial complex can be the very thing that will destroy man as it eats up all of his natural resources. Another specter haunting man is the dwindling food supply. With the population increasing so rapidly, and two-thirds of the world already suffering from malnutrition, The scientists that have studied this problem are quite concerned about the next 20 years when they anticipate that the present population will have doubled.
On the average, about once a year from the time of Christ, we have had major famines that have killed large numbers of people in localized areas. This year, there will be 120 million new individuals born. Roughly 15 million will die before they reach the age of five through causes that are related to inadequate food. That represents one-third of the total death rate that will occur this year. 48 million people will die. 15 million of them will be babies who die because of malnutrition. The situation is even more grim and more tragic than that. One of the most important forms of undernutrition and malnutrition is the failure of the child to get adequate protein resources to support its growth during its very early childhood development. If this happens, then the brain simply does not develop normally. These children grow up permanently stunted in their mental capacities. 7 of 10 are permanently stunted because of failure to obtain adequate sources of protein. What are the prospects for improvement of this situation? Not particularly good.
We have not been routinely immunizing against smallpox since 1971, because there's been no smallpox here for years, and therefore, each year there were more complications from the immunization, and no one was getting smallpox, so it was decided that it was unwise to immunize people. So soon we will have a whole generation of unimmunized people, and the prospect of enemy action seeding smallpox virus into our atmosphere is quite frightening.
The fact is that a biological agent, when used according to certain doctrines, can have a very devastating and final effect upon the personnel on whom it's used. The biological agent is a very large coverage weapon. It can be sprayed from aircraft, it can cover a very, very large area, and it can infect very many people in that area.
There are also grave concerns about the social upheavals in our society. It is not surprising that the crime, which is another severe problem, is increasing more rapidly among the children and teenagers than any other age group.
The American nuclear family, the mother, father, and the children, working together as an integral unit, has been disintegrating in our country. And this disintegration is costing us a terrible price. It isn't just the suffering from crime. Crime, of course, is essentially a youthful phenomenon, and the crime-prone age group tends to move down now to where the median age for burglars happens to be around 14 or 15, depending on the community. But really, the reason it's the country's greatest problem, in my opinion, is because it really comes from a breakdown in the American family. Why do we have one out of two marriages breaking up today? Well, I think the morality of the American people has been shattered by the new morality, so-called situation ethics.
Because of man's desperation, he has become a prey to all kinds of false messiahs who offer non-reason religious experiences as a solution to his dilemmas. It is always startling to observe the incredible lies man will believe once he has rejected the truth. One of the most awesome of nature's phenomena is the earthquake. It is a helpless feeling when that which is thought to be terra firma suddenly begins to move under your feet. Earthquakes have been increasing in the last century at an alarming rate. I am not here to give you a story of doom. I am convinced that in spite of all of the gloomy forecasts by the social scientist and the environmentalist, the world is on the verge of the most glorious age that man has ever known. All of these things that have been happening on our planet, the famines, earthquakes, the pestilences, the world wars, the false messiahs, are events that were predicted by Jesus Christ as signs of the end of man's futile efforts to govern himself. In the Bible, there are predictions of world events that must have seemed absolutely incredible to the people of that day and age. Even as recently as 200 years ago, many men scoffed at the predictions. The prophet Daniel, 2,500 years ago, said that in the last days, there will be an increase in man's knowledge and technology, to the extent that man would be traveling around the world. 200 years ago, the famous French philosopher Voltaire, speaking of Sir Isaac Newton, said, "Look at the mighty mind of Newton. When he got in his dotage, he began to study the book called the Bible. And it seems in order to credit its fabulous nonsense, we must believe, says Newton, that the knowledge of mankind will be so increased that we shall be able to travel at 50 miles an hour." The poor dotard. Brilliant men like Voltaire mocked the men of faith. And yet we see that Newton's faith has been substantiated, whereas Voltaire's criticism now seems foolish. From a biblical standpoint, one of the reasons I believe that man has come to the end of his time is the rebirth of the nation Israel. It is an event that was predicted by most of the Bible prophets and by Jesus Christ himself. As he gave the signs of the last days, he told his disciples that when the fig tree began to bud forth, that they would know that summer was nigh. "Even know," he said, "my coming is at the door." Then Jesus said that generation would not pass until all of these things be fulfilled. So the rebirth of the nation Israel marks the final generation of man upon the earth in this present order. And God took Ezekiel into a valley that was full of dry bones and scattered. And God said to Ezekiel, "Can these bones be made to live again?" And Ezekiel said, "Lord, thou knowest." And he watched as these bones came together. They formed a skeleton. And then flesh came upon the skeleton and muscles. And God said, "And so shall I gather again my people Israel that have been scattered among the heathen. And I will bring them back into their own land. And I will establish them there." And so God has kept this ancient promise to his people. He has brought them back into their land. He has established them there. And so we saw the miracle of a nation born in a day. We stand across from the Knesset, which houses the Israeli government. And here we see the fulfillment of God's wonderful word. Jerusalem the golden, Jerusalem the eternal city, the city of ancient and modern charm. For Jerusalem is a city, David said, that has been joined together. The scripture actually means that people have come together within Jerusalem, and here we see an interesting blend of Arab and Israeli alike living side by side. The word in the Hebrew actually means where people of all races can come together. Behind us is the Western Wall, which to the Jew is one of the most sacred places in the world. For just beyond this wall was Solomon's Temple, exactly where we do not know. But yet there at one time was the Holy of Holies, the place where God dwelt in the midst of his people. This is as close as they can come to that holy place. And since 1967, they have now been able once again to come and offer their prayers here at the Western Wall. It used to be called the Wailing Wall because they were not allowed here by the Arabs. But now that it is under Jewish control once again,
they can come and once more worship their God in this sacred place.
While in Europe, one sees an interesting formation of 10 nations federating together to form the European Community, which is a fulfillment of biblical prophecy.
It is incredible to realize that the building that I am sitting in front of has the potential of fulfilling a prophecy that was made over 2,500 years ago. This prophecy is recorded in the book of Daniel. We read that when Nebuchadnezzar was king of Babylon, the first major world-governing empire, that one night before he went to sleep, he was wondering, what is to come of the world? What will become of my empire? What will follow after me? And that night he had a very interesting dream. The dream troubled him extremely. When he woke up in the morning, he could not remember the dream, and he was curious as to its meaning. And so he gathered together his wise men and counselors, but they were not able to help him. Finally, Daniel was brought in, and Daniel said unto the king, God has shown to you the kingdoms of the world, those empires that will govern this world. In your dream, you saw a great image. It had a head of gold, it had shoulders of silver, it had a stomach of brass and feet of iron and clay. Daniel said, Nebuchadnezzar, you are the head of gold, but your empire is to be replaced by the Medo-Persian Empire, the shoulders of silver. That empire, in turn, will be replaced by the Grecian Empire, the stomach of brass. That, in turn, by the Roman Empire, the legs of iron. The final world-governing empire will be a federation of European nations that are related to the Roman Empire, but they will be joined together in a democratic union. In the European Community, we find the potential for the final world-governing empire.
A leader is going to arise to rule over the European Community that will almost hypnotize people. He will speak of peace, and the world that is searching for survival will hail him as their Messiah. However, the scriptures warn us that he is a false Messiah, for he is called the Antichrist by the Word of God.
And so we see this building, which houses the economic European Community, and here is the potential for the fulfillment of these prophecies.
In 1951, under the Kennedy round of negotiations, it was the posture of the U.S. government to encourage the formation of the European Community so as to have a strong Atlantic partner to help defend the free world. Today, we're becoming aware of the fact we have not so much a partner as a very able competitor. We have special studies that are exploring the takeovers of U.S. companies and banks by European interests. We have feature articles in some of our media, Europe, America's new rival. We have Forbes, is United States technology failing? Who now builds a better mousetrap?
What is happening to the dollar is of great concern to the average American family today. The dollar is devaluating on the foreign markets, and its purchasing power is diminishing in the United States. There is also the problem in the use of money itself, especially in all of the crimes where money is the primary object stolen. A solution that has been suggested is to assign every individual a number that will be tattooed under the skin of his hand or upon his forehead.
Family in Florida wants to be the first implanted with medical microchips, but a Canadian woman may have already beaten him to the punch. As Tech Live's Matt Markovich reports, there's no medical reason behind her implants. In fact, she says she just wanted to prove a point.
When Nancy Nesbett left her vet after getting her dog chipped, she had an idea.
So this is an x-ray of my two hands, clearly showing the microchips.
Why not get chipped herself?
I mean, I look at your x-ray, it's between the bones. Can you feel that in your hand there?
No, I don't. I can't feel it within my own hand, but if I touch it, I can feel it. Yeah, the chip is inside the barrel of that needle there, and once he pushes the needle in as to the right location, then there's a little plunger which he's pushing now, which goes through the barrel of the needle and pushes out the chip into my hand.
The world is now coming very close to that moment when the scripture will be fulfilled, which tells us that no man can buy or sell except he have a number on his right hand or on his forehead. Though there is a tremendous potential for the European nations to become a world-governing empire, they will never rise to that stature until something is done about the great threat that Russia poses to Western Europe. It was reported in one of the national magazines recently that Russia has over 28,000 tanks in Eastern Europe ready to strike. Our own intelligence agencies believe that Europe will fall within 36 hours from the time of Russia's initial attack. Therefore, we have no hope of holding Europe against this massive Russian force. Thus, in order for Western Europe to ever be a world-governing empire, something must be done about this Russian threat. Interestingly enough, the Bible states that Russia will be destroyed in an abortive invasion of Israel. In all the recent wars, and especially the Yom Kippur War in 1973, when Israel fought for its very survival, Russia was deeply involved. When the Syrians began their attack on October 6, 1973, they had some of Russia's latest equipment, such as this T-62 tank. And with 1,800 tanks, they attacked across this upper end of the Golan Heights in a 20-mile battle perimeter. When we stop to realize that when Hitler began his great invasion of Russia, that he had 1,000 tanks over a 200-mile perimeter, we realize what an intensive attack that was. A few hours after the attack began, at 2 in the afternoon, the Russian planes began to bring fresh supplies to both Syria and Egypt. The Russian technicians had trained the Egyptians and the Syrians. Few people realize how much Russia was involved in the 1973 war against Israel. 3 days before the war began, Russia put 2 spy satellites into orbit in order to film the battle conditions. A lieutenant in the Israeli army told me of the capture of Russian troops on the Golan Heights. When the tide of battle turned against Egypt and Syria, and the forces of General Sharon had trapped the 3rd Egyptian Army, the first ones to know that the 3rd Army was trapped were the Russians. This knowledge they received through their spy satellites. It was then that Russia began to press for a ceasefire. At 10:45 in the evening of October 24th, Dobrynin came to Kissinger with a message from Brezhnev. This note has been described by those who read it as brutal and threatening. According to the officials who read it, the content was, "We strongly urge that we both send forces to enforce the ceasefire, and if you do not, we may be obliged to consider acting alone." It is reported that Russia was loading paratroopers in the planes ready to invade Israel, and troop ships were on their way. 1973 was almost the end. President Nixon reacted to the note by calling a worldwide alert for our American forces. He probably averted World War III because a ceasefire was soon decided upon and the Middle East settled again into an unsteady peace. The Israelis were forced once again to fight for their lives and for the right to exist in this little piece of land.
Russia was involved, no doubt about it. Russia threatened to take an active part in the war, in the last stage of the war, when Israeli troops fought in Africa and endangered the Egyptian capital. Russia threatened to send troops, paratroopers, airborne troops, to fight in the Middle East. Russia sent air train to the Arabic countries. Russian freighters brought fuel, supplies, ammunition, everything to the Arabic countries. So Russia was no doubt a part of the fighting parties here, although Russian soldiers didn't fight against us. But we found after the war and during the war enough proof to know that in some stages before the war, in each Egyptian battalion, there were Russian officers in terms of advisors or in terms of really army officers even taking the command now and then. So we were fighting, of course, also against Russia.
We are presently on the Golan Heights, the area that was controlled by Syria prior to 1967. As we look at these gun emplacements and bunkers up here, we realize that this area was really a great area for what the Syrians were using it for. Now the Syrians would like it given back to them, and they are using the dollars from the oil in order to put pressure on the politics of government in order that they might regain this territory that cost so much. From this position, the Syrian spotters were able to direct the artillery fire on the farmers down below. What a tragic thing that this beautiful territory had to be turned into a hell. These are the Syrian bunkers and trenches that were constructed above the Hula Valley in the Golan Heights. They cost a lot of man hours and a lot of man dollars to develop, and they were purchased at the price of Israeli blood.
The major problem in the Middle East is that now that the Israelis have transformed the wilderness into a Garden of Eden, the Arabs want it for a Palestinian state. This has become the stalemate in peace negotiations in the Middle East. The whole situation is a sad drama of political intrigue, because the Russians are using the Syrians to fulfill their ends, and the Syrians are using the PLO to fulfill their ends. And Israel is the victim of these vicious attacks. It does not seem that peace is just around the corner. The positions of the opposing sides have polarized.
No exception to
this. So that it seems impossible for them to resolve.
We are now in a Palestinian refugee camp.
It is difficult to say just when the talks will break down completely, and they will try again to resolve their differences by another war. The Arabs talk so much about the right of the Palestinians to live in honor. It is obvious that the Palestinian situation has only been created to give the Arab nations an excuse for their next attack against the nation Israel in their determined effort to destroy it.
We as Palestinians, Begin and this government, they should know that there will be no peace in the area.
I was born Palestinian, although Jewish. My father, when he joined the British Army in the Second World War to fight against Nazi Germany, he joined as a Palestinian soldier. And the badge on his shoulder was saying Palestine. So first of all, nobody gave them the right to decide that they are the only Palestinians.
You are obliged to recognize the Palestinian.
They had the possibility in 1948 to declare an Arabic state of Palestine or whatever name, a PLO state or whatever name, which they have in their mind. But they did not do it because Arabs, Jordanians stole their rights, not Israelis. Many Palestinian refugees ran into Arabic countries. I feel sorry for them. I feel sorry for every human being in need, and I don't make any difference whether he is Jewish, Muslim, or Christian. But I'm sorry to say that their brothers don't feel sorry for them, because those people who kept them in refugee camps, in terrible conditions, in Jericho, or in southern Lebanon, or in northern Lebanon, or in Iraq, or wherever they kept them in a refugee camps, as animals in a zoo, or as dummies in an exhibition, every man has the right to live, every man has the right to be sovereign of his country, every man has the right to vote, every man has the right to live as he understands life. But the minute that in talking for human rights you are destroying other lives, and you are killing and you are murdering and you are butchering people just because they don't agree with your political terms, is it a pro-Russian motive or a pro-Israeli motive? A pro-American motive or a pro-Cuban motive? I can't stand them. But let us try to find out what kind of human rights. The right to live, the right to live in honor, the right to educate your children as you like to educate them, the right to believe in God.
God says that at this time his fury will arise in his face and that he will destroy this invading army. The word of God again declares that 5/6 of the invading army will be destroyed. Carcasses will lie unburied for 7 months. At that time, the Israelis will then begin to bury the carcasses. The scriptures tell us that when a person finds a skeleton, rather than touch it, they will set a flag by it, and professional buriers will go through the land to bury the bones. In another prophecy, God states, "And this is the plague whereby they that come against Jerusalem must die. Their flesh shall consume on their bones, and their eyes in their holes, and their tongues in their mouths." These are the same effects that the neutron bomb would produce. As we look around, we now understand what Jesus meant when he said, "Except those days be shortened, no flesh will remain upon the earth." We see the necessity for these days to be shortened because of the super weapons that man has developed that threaten to destroy this planet. When the Russian army is destroyed by God as it invades Israel, the way will then be paved for the 10 European nations to rise as the world governing power. Their new leader will inaugurate the new monetary system based on buying and selling with an assigned number, and the world will enter the final countdown. Almost 2,000 years ago, God stepped out of eternity into time and walked with man whom he created. As he left the earth, he promised that he would return again to establish a kingdom of love, understanding, and peace. His coming again is essential for man's survival. When his followers asked him for the signs of his return, he told them the signs to watch for, the chief of them being the rebirth of the nation Israel. Against incredible odds, the nation Israel was born again May 14, 1948. Jesus said the generation that saw the rebirth of the nation Israel would be the last generation.
Ours is always a biblical generation.
God would be fully justified if he just let man destroy himself. But because he loves, he has promised to intervene. All he asks is that you seek to know him and love him in return. Your survival depends on it. It is incredible to realize that the Bible speaks so explicitly of the world conditions today. Yet as we look at history and see how accurately it predicted past events, we shouldn't be surprised. One of the most astounding of all Bible prophecies is found in the book of Daniel, chapter 9. When the angel told Daniel that from the time the commandment would go forth to restore and rebuild Jerusalem, to the coming of the Messiah, the Prince, would be 69 sevens, or 483 years. The Babylonian calendar was predicated on a 360-day year, so that would equal 173,880 days. Now history tells us that on March 14th, 445 BC, Artaxerxes gave the commandment to Nehemiah to restore and rebuild Jerusalem. Exactly 173,880 days later, Jesus, on April the 6th, 32 AD, made his triumphant entry into the city of Jerusalem. But while he came here on the Mount of Olives, he stopped. Looking over the city, he cried and he said, "Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, if you only knew the things that belong to your peace in this thy day." It was their day of salvation. But he said, "Now they are hid from your eyes. Your city is to be leveled, and your children are to be slain in your streets." And as he saw that picture of destruction that would take place when Titus came in, he wept over the city. But Zechariah tells us that he's coming again, and his foot will set in that day upon the Mount of Olives, and this mountain will actually split right in the middle. And Jesus will then make his entrance again into the city of Jerusalem through this gate that is shut. For Ezekiel said that he saw the gate towards the east and it was shut. But he said it is prepared for the prince, that he shall enter in by that gate. And that day when he does, the Jew and the Christian alike will join together in hailing the Messiah as he establishes God's eternal kingdom upon this earth. It's time that you and I wake up to the fact that God is serious, that he does mean what he says, and that we are in these end times, and we must really make that commitment to Jesus Christ. Looking forward to hearing from you, and God bless you.